And welcome to our new Women's Walk with Christ vlog called Speaking Life. My name is Margaret Helton, and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to November. Hard to believe that we are already in the last 2 months of 2020, which is actually not a bad thing. I'm kind of glad it's almost over, like probably most of you.
Yeah.
So I'm excited that we're here again and be able to share this time with you. And so we have an exciting guest this week. This is one of our beautiful sisters from North Carolina, who I have had the pleasure of spending a lot of wonderful quality time with, enjoying her wisdom and her laughter and her hospitality. And she is one of the many reasons that North Carolina, in my heart, is my second home, and I miss so much being there. So without further ado, here's our beautiful sister, Gloria!
Hey, guys!
Hi, Gloria!
Good to be with you.
How are you?
I'm doing great.
You're doing great? How's North Carolina?
It's gorgeous today.
Is
We're
it?
In the 70s, sunny. It's a perfect day. And yesterday was as well.
Wow, that's exciting. We have a pretty good weather today, too. It's supposed to be yucky Monday, but today it's beautiful.
You all are more crazy weather-wise than we are here.
That is true. So here's one thing I need you to do. Can you please tell us exactly how to say your last name, please?
Bartelt.
Bartelt.
See? Bar with a B. Bartelt.
But not Bartlett.
No.
How often do you get that?
Oh, all the time.
You just did before when I was trying to figure out how to say your last name.
Well, I'm glad we're getting that straight finally. Yes. Well, this way you'll remember, guys. It's like a tilted bar. Bar tilt with an E. Bartelt.
Bartelt.
Tilt. That's what my husband said he always used to
get the wise Perry. He's so wise.
That's good. Now I'll remember it.
That's right. A tilted bar with an E. Bartelt.
Now we know, Margaret.
Okay. I've got it. It's locked in.
So second, then, how did you come to Women's Walk, Gloria?
Wow. Well, I always say it's very interesting that at least here in North Carolina, and probably everywhere, the men were much more active with marked men and then brought the women in. So my husband and my pastor at the time and a good friend of my husband's all went to a marked man weekend in Pennsylvania and came back. That's a story in itself, but came back quite different and quite impressed with the ministry. And all three of them said, you know, our wives have got to go. And so the three of us looked for the next weekend. And this was before North Carolina had Women's Walk here. So we flew out to Colorado. It was in April. And got off the plane. And fortunately, I grew up in the north, although now I live in North Carolina, so I knew how to drive in the snow. Because then we had to venture from the airport to Estes Park on those windy roads through the snow. And I was with two other southern, very southern women. So thankfully, I had driven in the snow before. So
yeah, it was an adventure.
To the YMCA.
Yeah, to the YMCA.
What year was that? April of when?
That was 2012, I believe. And that's, I should have checked on that because I always forget the year, but I'm pretty sure that's what it was.
So now could you share your mission statement with us?
Absolutely. As a loved, forgiven, and incredibly blessed woman, walking with Christ, I co-create a world of acceptance and grace by serving and being in relationship with others with wisdom, loyalty, gentleness, and joyful presence.
Yeah. That's so you. That gives me chills.
It's very fitting, yeah, for sure.
It's really cool to kind of revisit it and say, yeah, this still reflects, yeah, how God has designed me.
Has it changed at all since you originally wrote it?
Yes, it has changed by adding some new words and I guess traits and gifts within myself, and by adding just the gratefulness of, you know, feeling so blessed. Each time I went to serve in one of the weekends or bridges, God just reveals something else that I'm just so incredibly thankful for. So it was really nice to kind of revisit it and see how, remembering kind of back to the weekend or the bridge where God kind of said, yep, this is you as well. Or I have said, man, I am so incredibly blessed, you know, and just added all those things in, because yes, the first weekend is so powerful, but every time I go and become a staff person in Women's Walk, God speaks so loudly and so creatively.
It's like we always say, all of us are continuing to heal and transform as we go through, you know, so it should change, you know. Absolutely. We can always add new gifts that we find that we didn't think we had before.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
I love that part about it.
Yeah. I love it as well.
Yeah.
I really do.
Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah. Thank you so much. So we'd like to talk to you now about your Enneagram number. So you said you're an Enneagram number 2?
Yes.
Okay. And we'll talk a little bit more about, if people aren't familiar, but tell us a little bit about like how you use your Enneagram number in your day-to-day life. And if you took the test more than once, talk to us about your journey to find your number.
We read about it and took a test. And I have pretty much always solidly been a 2. I have taken one test one time after years of not really thinking about the Enneagram, and it was leading me to be a 3. So, but I always come back and, you know, people affirm, as well as just my life in general affirms that I'm a 2. Yeah. And it's really, as you know, as I've gone over these questions, it's really interesting to kind of think about Women's Walk and Enneagram. It affects me day to day, because number 2 is the helper. And you know, I love the Enneagram because you learn your strengths, and you learn what you can be as a 2 when you're healthy, and you also learn what 2s look like when they are very unhealthy, and how we kind of weave, you know, through health and lack of health, and then you learn also with the Enneagram how you react to stress, and how a 2 under stress could react and be perceived. So daily I'm kind of checking myself and seeing myself kind of play out as a 2, and always trying to recognize some of the unhealthy tendencies that 2s can exhibit. So yeah, it's interesting, Margaret. I don't know if you think about it daily too, because Margaret said you were 2. It's with us, you know, our Enneagram types. Once we feel like that's where we are, or that's what we are, it's hard not to be aware of it in health or lack thereof.
Yeah, like you said, I'm a two, and so I know a lot about the two. I know a little bit about the other numbers, and for those of you who are watching and don't know much about the Enneagram or have never taken a test, the Enneagram is this kind of like a personality type test, and you would have a number, you're assigned a number 1 through 9 after you take a 100 question quiz. And so I have studied it a little bit. Rhonda White is very interested in the Enneagram, and she's done a ton of workshops, and she's the one that kind of gave me my first Enneagram book and asked, you know, she encouraged me to really dig into it, and she's also a two. So us twos will stick together, but I pulled up a couple different things after you told us what your Enneagram number was about two that I just wanted to read just to kind of give you, like you were talking about, it gives you just a little bit more about how to recognize yourself and your personalities and how you go in times of, you know, when you're healthy and in strength and when you go in times of stress. And so, and I think the thing that I love so much about the Enneagram is after I read it, I was like, whoa, that's spot on. Like,
yes. That,
why have you been reading my diary? Like, it was freaky right. How similar yeah. It was to me. So
I was told that the way you figure out your numbers, you read about the numbers, and then the number that you're reading where your heart rate goes up, that's more likely than not your number. It's kind of like, yeah. Whoa, how do they know me so well? It's really very interesting.
Yeah. So this comes from the Enneagram Institute, and it says that twos are empathetic, sincere, and warm-hearted. They're friendly, generous, and self-sacrificing, but can also be sentimental, flattering, and people-pleasing. Do you consider yourself a people-pleaser?
Oh, bingo, yes. Yeah.
So a lot of, I listen to Ian Morgan Cron. He has a podcast called Typology, and yes. He calls a two a befriender. So it's also called the helper, but the befriender. Just, he says, this is a quote that I pulled up from him. In short, discovering the truth to who we are in regarding work, but it can be difficult and unsettling. Doing the work is good, but it's not easy. And then another kind of chart that Julie Ryder, one of our Women's Walk board members, has shared with us in the past when we've studied, because we've also studied it as a board and management team, just about like how to relate to one another and just based on your Enneagram number. And she shared with us a chart. If the Enneagram wheel was Winnie the Pooh characters, which Winnie the Pooh character would you be? So would you like to take a guess about what twos might be?
You know, what's crazy about that is the friend that originally introduced me to the Enneagram was wanting to write a book exactly about that, the Winnie the Pooh characters and what Enneagram number they would be.
Whoa.
tell me, I can't remember though what the two would be.
So this chart shows that Kanga is the two okay. character. And I Wikipedia'd Kanga, and it actually is really true, I think, about twos, that Kanga is kind-hearted, calm, patient, and docile. She likes to keep things clean and organized and offers motherly advice and food to anyone who asks her.
Yeah.
Protective over Rue almost obsessively and treats him with kind words and gentle discipline. And when I was listening to your mission statement, I thought, oh, there's a lot of similarities yeah. about wisdom and gentleness to your Kanga.
Yeah, isn't it? That's interesting. Yeah. Yeah, that's very true. Now, going to Spirit Circle every other week, the Holy Spirit really can point out in my heart, you know, the healthy and unhealthy side of where I am based on, you know, my work, or through my work, it seems like I can get a greater hold of being more healthy as a two. So yeah, there's such connection with Women's Walk and knowing your number. It's what I was saying. It's a great topic to kind of align with Women's Walk. So yeah, it's interesting that you all included that as a question to go over, because I think it's really
And as we wrap up our conversation about Enneagram, Kim, would you like to know what Pooh character you are?
Oh, what could it be? I'm a 9 on the Enneagram, if anybody would like to know.
And you are Winnie the Pooh. That's your character.
Winnie the Pooh. I always have a grumbly in my tumbly, I'm sure.
Soft-voiced, cuddly, lovable, quiet teddy bear. That's you.
Oh, yes.
Now I can go get a look at you. That's what I'm going to go do.
So fitting for you, Kim.
Yeah, Winnie the Pooh.
Because we all love you and want to cuddle with you.
I miss, that is like the worst part of this whole 2020. I'm like, man.
I know it.
And you go to see people and like it's your automatic, how?
I know, right?
Self-hug.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm tired of hugging myself.
I know. I hope we don't get out of practice where we enter rooms and not hug.
Right? Oh, hard.
It's been a table. I'm going to start doing it again.
Yeah, sometimes I'm watching something on TV where people are hugging. I'm like, that looks weird. We're not allowed to do that.
Don't do that.
Right.
Stop doing that. Okay, so our next question for you is, which you kind of already answered, why is it important for you to go to Spirit Circle?
I did kind of launch into that, didn't I?
That's cool.
Yeah, just to kind of emphasize why it is so important. You know, I feel like I can go along my life day to day thinking everything, I'm fine, everything's fine. And I guess this brings twos in a little bit as well. We twos tend to think we don't do much wrong. We're kind of, you know, we're the helpers, we're just the ones that swoop in and befriend people. And so for me, truly, a lot of times what God does in Spirit Circle is to help me see my sin, really, is the way I always like to put it, because we are all, you know, sinners saved by grace. And that is incredibly helpful for me, because I can leave Spirit Circle being reminded of how loved I am, you know, regardless of the things in my life and the things that I do or have done or my tendencies that are more sinful. And that's exactly why I need Jesus. So I come out of Spirit Circle always just so thankful for being a child of God, mm-hmm. and being, you know, just saved by, you know, Jesus's death on the cross, and being loved as a pure, pure white child of God. So yeah, I can go on and on about that. But Spirit Circle just is, you know, one of those things that you tend to think, well, gosh, do I really want to go this week? Or, you know, do I have something else that's more important? Mm-hmm. And you carve out the time and you go, and God just speaks in such wonderful, specific ways in our lives that really do help to lead us to more healthy versions of ourselves.
Mm, that's beautiful.
So yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Me.
I love it. I love the sense of the Holy Spirit, you know, kind of focusing. We may bring something to Spirit Circle and think one thing about it, and then when we listen to the Holy Spirit, we see exactly what he wants us to see which is often different than we thought about our work. So it's pretty powerful.
It is. I find that happens to be the case a lot. Like, oh, that's what he was trying to teach me. You know, like I'm so closed-minded when I'm by myself thinking about it. But when I just get quiet and hear what he wants, I'm like, oh, that's totally not what I thought. But that makes sense. That's why I'm here this week. That's why I came to, and sometimes it's not for me. It's I'm going and I'm end up just supporting my sisters, which is even better.
Exactly.
You know, just to be there.
Yeah. And that brings up a really important thought for me. And I don't know if this is true for you, Margaret, but as a two, we're so often the ones that feel like we have to, like I said earlier, swoop in and, you know, help be there for people in need. Women's Walk, you know, was what was so great for me, even in the main weekend, as a two. You're constantly engaged in conversations where you're trying to help, you know, you're not focusing on yourself often because we tune into others and read others so well that we're more interested in how we can, you know, be in relationship with this other woman. And for me to be able to go to the weekend and just, this is for you, you know, this is your time for the Holy Spirit to speak to you about, you know, your wounds. And that was so helpful, you know. And just how we say every week at Spirit Circle, a woman does her own work and is responsible for her own work. That is so good for twos. Kind of go, just remember that. Get you out of here. Let the woman and the Holy Spirit do their work.
And I often remind myself of the FRAP acronym that we use. I'm not here to fix, I'm not here to rescue, I'm not here to give you advice, I'm not here to project my own stuff onto you. I'm just here to help you be the guide to listening to what the Holy Spirit is saying to you.
Absolutely, yes. That was just so very freeing to me and so good each week. Yes, it's like, you know, unfortunately, it kind of shows that maybe unhealthy side of the two for me, the one that is there for someone else. And so anyway, that's one of the things that I love about Spirit Circle as well.
Awesome. Okay, next question. If laughter were the fuel in the tank of life, would your gauge show your tank as full, half full, or nearly empty, and why?
Absolutely full. I love to laugh. I was thinking about laughter, and I grew up with a lot of laughter. Mm. I just came from visiting with my immediate family, my siblings. I have a brother and two sisters, and we laugh all the time, and we laugh quite a bit. So it's nice to think, and I love to laugh. I just really do. So absolutely full. I have, you know, the reputation in my family now, my husband and my children, that I have to be careful when I get laughed too hard. I laugh until I cry, I'll put it that way.
And it's the best, isn't it?
Yes.
It's the most freeing thing sometimes.
Yeah.
Medicine.
It is.
Strengthens your abs and everything.
Yeah, I bet you have abs of steel.
No, I do not.
Well, keep laughing, woman.
I have abs of Winnie the Pooh. That's what
Winnie the Pooh abs?
Yes. I am owning my kindness.
Okay. So, Gloria, we'd love to hear more about your daily spiritual practices, or maybe it's a weekly or a monthly spiritual practice that you you have in your life.
Yeah, I I love this. I've always been an active person, an active kid. My body always needs to be moving. Having some kind of movement in there that's regular gets my heart rate right up. So one of my favorite practices is either walking or when I'm, training for a run or something, to combine my time alone. I usually will run on a track where it's just a circle and people say, oh, that's boring. But then I pray, like if I want to do 2 miles or 3 miles, I'll figure out how many laps that is. And then I'll really devise in my head what I want to pray for. I usually pray for my four kids, my husband, other needs. And I'll just pray as I walk or run. It's just become really important to me, and it keeps me doing both. It keeps me getting that activity my body needs, and I keep praying. And it keeps me, it gives me the opportunity to be alone with the Lord while I'm outdoors and while I'm moving. So that is really a frequent practice. And then it's just, I guess this is interesting. In some ways I want to say something negative about this, in that, I combine prayer with running because I want to be moving. And then this other practice is that sometimes as we get older, we wake up in the middle of the night, and that is my time. I used to get disappointed. Okay, my sleep has been disrupted. But now I go and I have this quiet area. I have to get out of my bedroom, and I go and I read what I'm reading in the Bible, and use that opportunity to read the word. And I read the word for a while, and then you slowly but surely get tired, and then I go back to bed. So those two things are constant and consistent. The other thing my husband and I try to do is to keep the Sabbath, and we've done, this is not quite as consistent. We try to, make a meal on Saturday to be, eaten the next day, and try to do something quiet together, really kind of make the Sabbath a Sabbath. That's not as consistent. We were doing it for, more consistently at one point in time. But it's nice to be reminded, it's nice to have practices. So you can say, yeah, that's a great question, because you want to say, yeah, I do practice that. And you're reminded that, when I practice that, life is richer. Life is, God is definitely closer, and my life is more still with these practices. Otherwise, my life would just be always going. So to have, if we don't have a practice, we can always think about what practice fits into our lives, and then truly practice it.
So, and we can only find an excuse for it not to, right? But there's always, there's time in your car. There's, like you said, time when you're walking the track, or even most of mine is usually when I'm driving to work. Like it's the most quiet time I can have by myself. And so it's like, I got to take that time. Like, however it is, I have to just be quiet. And so it's just finding those little niches of time in your life to start some sort of a practice, because it can get hard,
Yeah.
I always say, I'm going to do this every morning. Okay, well, something might come up in the morning, or God forbid, now we have our time change, and so my whole body's thrown off. And so I know every day I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to drive. So, wow, this is a perfect time. So yeah, you do. You have to really get in the practice of it so that it becomes a habit, I think is what it is.
Yeah. And I like how you were combining your exercise, your walking or your running with your spiritual practice. So it's like you're multitasking, and as women, we do that very well.
That's
you're doing
true.
Two things at once and you're being very efficient.
Yeah. And you know, I know I say this kind of as unfortunately I'm more consistent, or at least my desire, I have like this physical desire to go out and move. And I want to say, I should have that desire to go to prayer just as strong. But it has become just as strong since I've combined them. Mm-hmm. And it gives me this opportunity, you know, to really, and it's so sweet because, you know, you can lay out, it just has helped me pray for each of my kids for a pretty good length of time, you know, and rather than thinking I'm going to pray and not. So it has really helped me be a more consistent prayer warrior. And I love to pray.
It's the best.
Yeah.
Our last question for you is, what is your favorite Bible teacher or author that you like?
I have two.
Okay.
And if that's okay. They're totally two different genres. And the first is Francine Rivers. I love her testimony, first of all. She's, you know, a woman who knew she was going to be a writer, started to be a writer, and she wrote romance novels. And I've never read one of her novels when she was just writing romance novels, but God really kind of convicted her. And I think it was like through writer's block, or he convicted her and then kind of disabled her from being able to write. And anyway, she became a strong believer. And now what she writes still has some romance to it often, but it is, a woman who writes so well, stories where she lays out, you know, life in our world where there's, you know, sin and betrayal and everything that we see on earth. And then she, you know, all of her stories weave God's hand in them in such an amazing way. If you haven't read Redeeming Love by her, by Francine Rivers, it is the most fantastic. It's one of my favorite books. So she's right up there top. And then secondly is Tim Keller. Tim Keller, who has just a way with words. I'm always, because I've several family members that do not know the Lord, so I'm always looking for ways to share the gospel in ways that unbelievers will hear. And he's so about that. And so I love anything he does. So he would be my second favorite. And of course, I can't say his name without saying we need to be praying for him. He's actually going through pancreatic cancer right now. But he's an amazing preacher, an amazing author, and one that I admire greatly.
I think when I read his, he makes it seem so, it's easy to understand. That's what I like.
Yes.
I don't have to go and, okay, now I got to stop reading that and figure out what he's talking about there. I can just read it and I can understand it. Like he speaks, not to me, but not that I can't read, but it's like dumbed down for me so that I can just understand
it.
Just,
no? Yeah. He's so clear, right? He's in his presentation.
Yeah, yeah. It's clear and simple. Like, oh, wow. Yeah, that's so simple.
Right. The last book I read of his recently was The Prodigal Son. And he takes the story of the prodigal son and highlights things about that story that I have never thought about before. And so that would be a book I highly recommend of his as well. But yeah, so those are my two favorites.
Thank you for those recommendations. We'll have to check it out for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Prodigal son, writing it down.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Write that down.
I wrote it down. I made a note.
It's a good one. It's a good one.
Great. Well, now we will enter into the part of our show that is one of Kim and I's favorites, the your funny fuel for Fridays. And these are kind of just like rapid questions for fun, just like your favorite things or funny things. So what's your favorite meal?
My favorite meal is, once again, I have two answers, but I'll answer them quickly. Either chicken piccata, I love that, or breakfast, where it's just two eggs over easy on a piece of Dave's killer bread with butter and jam, and ooh, all those flavors mixed together. So good.
Those are good. I thought you were going to throw in quinoa, Gloria.
I know. I really kind of censored myself on that one. It's kind of a inside joke with Kim and me, because I fed her quinoa one time when she came. Kim, but didn't you admitted later you liked it?
I did. I said, okay, I will try it, because my mom always told me, be polite.
No thank you helping.
And it was actually delicious.
So thank you, Gloria, for broadening her food palate, because it's a little narrow sometimes.
Every time I go, she does.
And now, North Carolina quinoa.
It is. And I'm now, like,
you've got to try this.
Yeah, the only bread we eat in our house, Gloria, is Dave's bread. Now.
I conquered it.
See? Every little time Gloria feeds me something a little bit different. Maybe one day you'll feed me a banana. No.
We'll give you $100, Gloria, if you get her to eat a banana.
That will be my next challenge. I think there might have been dried cranberries in that quinoa salad. So Kim's like, no.
Okay, your next. What is your favorite or not favorite movie?
Oh, okay. I'm such a bad rule follower, because this is all I can think of. And it's, I mean, not that I can't think of a favorite movie, but I'm watching a series right now that it just stays on my mind. So I need to share this. Anne with an E. I don't know if you guys have seen it. It's on Netflix. You know, it's basically a movie in short segments. Anne with an E. I'm not kidding. You guys need to watch it.
I know Anne of Green Gables, but I haven't watched it. Yes. It's really good.
And as I was thinking about this question for this, it's, you know, yeah, a young girl who had been through such difficult childhood wounding, and then how her life is being just enhanced, and it's just every episode I'm crying. It reaches my heart. So there's only three seasons of it, but and I'm on the third season now, but it is, I find it to be so good, and I've even gotten my husband to watch it. I think he does that mostly for me, but we're enjoying watching it together. So that's my answer to that one.
Well, I'll have to check that out because Glenn and I finished up a series. So now we can add a new one.
Yeah, I loved it. I love it. I'm still enjoying it.
Nice.
So your last we will do is what's the most fun thing you've done in during the pandemic or during your quarantine thus far?
I've got to say, really towards the beginning, I was being a lot more creative. And, you know, during the beginning of the pandemic, I think we were, you know, trying to figure out how you do life, you know, when everything was closed down. And I had gotten a wonderful gift from my family last year for Christmas, and it's a blow-up kayak, and I hadn't used it yet. So this was when my daughter was still living at home. So she and I just took it out, went to the to a nearby lake, blew up that thing, got it all together all by ourselves, got into that kayak, and we just kayaked around that lake. And it was so much fun.
That sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was like an adventure in the midst of such a strange shift in life, you know, that I think it had much greater impact on us because it was during the pandemic. It was like, we could do this, you know. we're living together, we're further than 6 feet from these people in their other fishing boats or whatever, and it was great fun. That tops the list.
I can imagine you two in a kayak together.
Yeah.
There has to be a lot of laughs going on.
Oh, yeah. Lots of ab strengthening there.
Imagine. And she, both of you have this laugh that just makes you laugh. You don't even know what they're laughing at. You're just going to laugh because they're just funny.
Laughter, I love
it. Always something to laugh at, right?
There is, and it's like that's so, and you can see how much you're really enjoying it. It's not like you're laughing just because you feel like you should. You're like enjoying it, and you can see it in your face. You know, like it's bright and it's.
Well, and I have to admit, when I'm with my daughter, she's often laughing at me.
I'll have to admit, Gloria, when I was with your daughter, we were kind of laughing at you too, but
I could imagine. I knew it was happening. I knew it.
The truth comes out.
It does. Exactly. But it was a good way.
Yeah.
Well, Gloria, thank you so much for joining us. It was so
nice. Yeah, I think it's time to go.
That's all for today.
I have to exit stage left. No, I actually really don't want to go. This has been fun.
See, we told you it was going to be easy.
You're right. You were so right.
Yeah, and it's a nice way for people to get to know you that haven't had the chance to staff with you in North Carolina and meet with you. And they get to see how awesome I know you are just by this little bit of time with you. So,
well, Women's Walk is awesome, and the relationships formed are just, so great.
They are.
Hard to describe.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I can honestly say now I like two people who are Tar Heel fans.
Oh, and Kim, did you notice where I'm broadcasting from?
Oh, yes, I did, Gloria.
And right up there on the wall is Roy Williams looking down at you. So you better be careful.
Looking down at you.
I noticed you were in my room, Gloria. I noticed.
This is the bedroom where when Colorado comes here, they can stay in this bedroom. Anytime. They don't even have to be here for any bridge reason or anything.
Well, maybe in 2021, I'll get to sleep in that
bedroom. That would be awesome, Margaret. You have a bed here waiting for you.
Margaret, those are the best two beds you will ever sleep in your life. They're so comfortable.
Ooh,
they are told they are very comfortable. Yes,
they are. They're the best.
Yeah.
Awesome.
The decorations,
Tar Heels.
I should have worn my Duke shirt, Gloria.
Well, before a riot breaks out.
Really, Margaret, help me. Help me here.
We really do appreciate you coming on, Gloria, and thank you for taking the time to talk to us. And we just hope you have a good rest of the day, and bless you. Thank
you. You both as well. It was fun. Thanks. Okay.
Gloria.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Bye.
So I think one of the things that Gloria said that was, I really liked her spiritual practices and just, you know, that it can be really simple. You know, sometimes when you hear spiritual practice, you hear like, oh, it has to be so devout and it has to be so serious. And, you know, it can be something as simple as, you know, walking or running and connecting with God, you know, and it's something that you do, like Gloria said, like when you do it on a consistent basis, like you're the best version of yourself that you can be. So I definitely like that.
I do. And that's what you're saying. I like it how people can make it so simple where sometimes it can be overwhelming. Like, oh my gosh, I have to have an hour of my day. If I don't have an hour to just read the Bible, and just, it doesn't have to be that hard. You know, like you say, you can go for a walk or drive in your car. Or, I mean, sometimes it's 5 minutes. He doesn't care if it's 5 minutes or 5 hours, just something, just bring him into your day. And it's shocking how it changes your whole perspective for the whole day. So
absolutely. Yeah,
I do. I love to hear people's different practices. Makes it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yay.
So continuing with our FFFFs, the faithful fuel for your Friday. In the NIV version,
okay.
This verse is Psalms 34, verses 1-4. And so it says, I will exalt the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all of my fears.
I love that.
Your version say?
So my version, I did it in the New Living Translation, and it says, I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I prayed to the Lord and he answered me. He freed me from all of my fears. And like I was telling you this, I was drawn to this mostly for that very last verse, verse 4, and how he freed me from all of my fears. And I think that, I think maybe we talked about this last time too, that everybody is just living in that place, you know, and it's so easy to stay, especially with everything that's going on in the world right now, not just with the political part of it, but just everything. And now everybody's in Colorado. I don't know for everybody else, but now we're back to all level threes. And so our fears are a little more heightened. Mm-hmm. And we just have to really remember that he can free us from all of those fears, and that fear is not from him, right? He doesn't want us to be afraid. And so we just have to really, really hang on to that and not let that fear take control of who we are and what we do in our daily lives, because that's not productive. And that doesn't allow us to grow and be, just be who we're supposed to be if we just are constantly afraid of everything.
Yeah.
Which is kind of what you were talking about your weekend with John, you know, the fear that you stepped into.
I did. I was able to step into a fear. My husband is an active hunter, and he does archery, and so last weekend, and I am not, I've never shot a gun in my life, but last week, he asked me if I, you know, we had some vacation days saved up, and so we were on vacation, and he asked me if I wanted to go shooting, and I never shot a gun in my life, and I'm afraid of it, you know, I'm afraid, you know, it's a weapon, it's, you know, it could hurt someone, it could kill someone, you know, but through his coaching and his guiding and stepping through my fears, I was able to shoot the gun, and I will tell you, it turns out I'm a pretty good shot. Who knew? So just him allowing me to have that new experience and him helping me not be afraid of it. God has given us something fun to do together now. So
see, right? And it was just a fear of it. And now you're a marksman.
Woman.
Yes.
So yeah, if you see me on the cover of a hunting magazine or a shooter magazine, now you know, secret's out. I'm a markswoman.
Now I'm a little afraid. But I think that's awesome, you know? I think that's cool. I'm glad you guys got to do that.
Yeah, we had a really special time together. So
I'm glad.
So
thank you for sharing that.
Of course. And finally, we will move into our ABCDEF, and the acronym that we use is, and because Christ died, everyone is free. So Miss Kim, will you share with us this week of your ABCDEF that you experienced?
So for me, my F is slightly changed. It is, and because Christ died, everyone is forgiven this time. And so a lot of you have known or know most of my story or the parts that you need to know. So my middle son had a really rough year a couple years ago and was dating this girl that for us, it was easy for us to blame her for a lot of the choices that he made. Due to the fact that we just didn't want to see that in him, you know, and to think that he would take himself down that path. And so it was easy for us to blame her. And I quite frankly had no empathy for her. I had no, I really could have cared less to ever see her again in my life. I didn't think she deserved my forgiveness. And I didn't think she deserved anybody's forgiveness. So through the last year, He's shown me a lot of different things in my life, God. And one of them was the forgiveness for myself. And that I talked about that last time, that I actually do deserve that as well. And so come to find out recently that my son and her are engaged. So that was super hard for me to hear because I don't think that they were right for each other. And it really was hard for me. But by his grace and by his mercy, her and I met Thursday of this week. And she deserves that. And she deserved me to hear her and to open my heart. And I was able to forgive her. She apologized to me about the way her part in it and how it hurt us and hurt our family. And I was able to actually speak those words that I accepted her apology. And that was not easy for me. And it was really through his grace and by talking to my beautiful sisters in Women's Walk and being able to do some work through that I was able to give that to her, and she truly deserves that because I do, and so does everybody in this life. And it doesn't change who I am. It doesn't make me feel better about me to be able to give that to her. So that was kind of a release for me too, and also for her. And I just feel like now that's a new step for us, and now we can start a new journey in our life together. And so she has been forgiven. And I think that's awesome because I think, like I said, everybody deserves that in their life. So that is my ABCDEF for the week.
Well, and how beautiful that you can have that peace with her and be able to forgive her as now that she's going to be in your family for a really long time. And so that you don't have to have that angst and that anxiety every time you see her or during the holidays or whatever. You really have that peace. And so, like you said, that was really more for you maybe than anything else.
Yeah, and it really was. And like, I think I told you that, like, for me, if anybody knows me, that all I want for my boys in their life is to be happy and to be loved. And being able to spend that time with her, I really believe that now. And I see that that's what she wants for him. And she wants the best for him, just like I do. And so that really just put my mama's heart to peace. And now I can really just trust and be open to her and be a light for her. You know, maybe that's what it really is about, is now I get to be a light for her too. So I'm excited about that opportunity too. So
that's great. Well, thank you so much for sharing your story and your ABCDEF.
So. Thank you. I'm being more conscious and aware of that since we started talking about them. I was like, okay, what's that going to be this next time? I got to start paying attention.
Your heightened alertness.
Very good.
Well, that brings us to the end of our show, but we just, again, want to say thank you for spending the time with us to watch this episode, and we hope that you learned something new and that you were able to have a little bit of a break from this crazy world that we live in. And if you have comments about something that we talked about or need more information, please feel free to email us. My email address is margaret@womenswalkwithchrist.org, and Kim's email address is kim@womenswalkwithchrist.org. And definitely give us a thumbs up or comment if you're watching this on Facebook or on YouTube. Let us know that you're here. And if you have any suggestions for future episodes, we'd love to hear them. So shoot them our way. Shoot them. You see what I did there? Shoot them our way.
Good, Margaret. We do. We thank you all for who have taken the time to watch our show. We really appreciate it. And we love all the comments. And I know both of us really tried to respond as quickly as we can. So thank you so much for taking all of the time that you have already. And we just really appreciate it.
So we'll see you next time. Bless you.